Hello and welcome to KAUST Live. I'm Nicholas Demille. Today we're joined by Stephen Koonin. He is the director of the NYU Center for Urban Science and Progress. Stephen, thank you so much for joining us today.
I'm happy to be here, Nicholas.
Stephen is speaking with us. You're here to give a keynote, which you gave this morning as part of the HPC conference. That keynote was about enabling the megacities of the not-so-distant future to deliver services effectively, efficiently, sustainably. Tell us a little bit more about that.
So, you know, cities are obviously important. Most of humanity now lives in cities, and three-quarters of us by the middle of the century will be in urban areas. And we need cities to be efficient, sustainable, equitable, quality of life issues, economic opportunity, and so on. And we have an opportunity now because of the flood of data that's available to us, whether through city records or sensors or the phones that we all carry around, to use that data to better understand cities and then to make them better.
So how do you envision this working exactly? One centralized massive repository or lots of sort of distributed ways that you collect and process this data?
So every city will, of course, be different. But within a given city, it helps a lot to be able to have access to multiple types of data all in one place. Since you might, for example, want to correlate pollution with public health, or you might want to be able to correlate mobility with economic development.
That's an interesting example. So mobility and economic development, how would you measure and then how would you implement that sort of assessment?
So if you're going to start a new economic activity, let's suppose you put in a factory or something like that, you'd like to be able to analyze the existing commuting patterns that people, where they're living, be able to get to the factory, but also how would you plan new housing so as to best allow people to access the factory or to move goods out of the factory or into the factory. So this mix between land use and transportation is a classic one in urban planning, but we can do it so much better now because we have the data sources available to us.
Now the center that you're the director of, this is a fairly new entity, am I right about that?
Yes, we're just about 5 years old.
Okay.
We were stood up as a competition within New York City. We're one of several centers that were stood up at the universities in New York City. And we are now working on our fourth class of master's students. So we're doing research as well as education.
Very interesting. And what's the big picture for the center? Is it half research, half education? Give us a sense.
Well, building on the traditions that I experienced growing up and in my career, it's a good mix of research and education together. They're really intertwined together. There are some basic skills we need to give the students, but we use real research examples in that, and then we get them to work for about a third of their time with us on a real project, often in collaboration with the city.
Interesting. What kinds of projects do you have any in mind that are interesting going on?
One of the more understandable and impactful is the students did an analysis of who was using the New York City web portal for indigent services. So if you're poor, there's a portal you can go to, and you can analyze by neighborhood where are the users, and see that some of the poorest areas of the city were not using it as much as that you would have expected or they should be. So the city started an advertising campaign in those neighborhoods to make people more aware of their ability to access services.
I don't understand totally the definition for mega cities. Certainly there are a couple that seem to fit the definition.
I think it's a fluid definition.
Okay.
8 to 10 million or more. New York City proper is 8 point something million. The broader metropolitan area is 16. You look at Mexico City, Tokyo, Hong Kong, Singapore, you see cities of that size.
Okay, and what sets them apart? Is it simply their size or is there something else?
I think it's scale, but once they get to a certain point, they start to disaggregate. And so you will find people who can't commute all the way across the city, and there tends to be a disconnect between them. mm-hmm. between the different parts of the city.
Okay.
But also I think it's governance challenges. Mm-hmm. So New York City, again, the city I know well, is fortunate to have a single government for the city proper, 8 million people. If you go to Southern California, for example, mm-hmm. within the Los Angeles basin, there are 50 different government entities, small towns, all of which are more or less cheek by jowl, and getting them all to cooperate and agree with one another mm-hmm. is a major challenge.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. You served as the U.S. Department of Energy's Undersecretary for Science, and you did some consulting in particular on resource development. Can you talk a little bit about that?
So the role I had was something like the chief scientist in the department. Steve Chu was the secretary, very distinguished scientist, and some people said I was Steve Chu's Steve Chu, because Steve was advising the president on various matters, technical mm-hmm. matters. We worked very hard to push some programs that have come to fruition. So you should understand the Department of Energy portfolio is very broad.
Massive. Yeah.
It has about $6 billion a year in basic research, mm-hmm. Nuclear and particle physics, computing, biology, materials. Then it's got about $5 billion a year in energy technologies, wind, solar, fossil, nuclear, the electrical grid. Mm-hmm. And then about $12 billion or so in nuclear security okay. work. We spent some time trying to move high-performance computing forward in the department during my time, which was 2009 to 2011. Computing is such a fundamental technology to everything we want to do. Mm-hmm. It's a technology that feeds on itself in the sense that one computer is used to design the next generation. So you don't want to fall behind. And we were able to get shaped up but not fully established the so-called exascale initiative, which is the next generation of high-performance computing. Mm-hmm. I'm pleased to say since I left the department, the administration and the Congress have put that program into place, mm-hmm. and we're now moving forward to establish an exascale capability early in the 2020s.
Mm-hmm. And what is the intent? What is it intended to accomplish, the exascale in particular?
Well, so at one level, it's just a numerical benchmark. Mm-hmm. Exascale is 10 to the 18th, or a million trillion operations, floating point operations per second. Mm-hmm. What it means practically is you can build better models of weather, of drug design, of how a city works mm-hmm. than you could previously, and explore a broader range of models than you could otherwise. One of the things we're involved with, and I expect is of interest here, mm-hmm. is how can we move this capability, which is largely in the universities and the national laboratories, out into the commercial world mm-hmm. and get large companies and small companies to understand what high-performance computing can do for them. Mm-hmm. And there are deliberate efforts in the United States to try to open up these computers to commercial firms.
And this would be in applications such as megacity?
Not only megacities, but mm-hmm. also design, aircraft design. You can cut the number of test flights you need to do. Mm-hmm. Automobile tire design, mm-hmm. or actually truck tire design. There's a famous story of how one of the tire companies was able to cut the design time mm-hmm. and improve the performance by using a lot of simulation.
Okay, so supporting industry.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Growth. It lets you shorten the design cycles, but also cut the performance margins more tightly if you have confidence in your ability to predict.
Right, very good. Another big project that you've been involved in was the 30-meter telescope. Talk a little bit about this project.
Yeah, it seems like all my life, all I've been doing is getting big projects started and then moving on once they're on their own.
Right.
So Caltech, where I was at the time, has a long tradition of astronomy. And one of the ways you move not only astronomy, but in general all of science forward, is by developing new instrumentation that nobody has ever developed mm-hmm. before. Caltech in the early 90s opened up the twin Keck telescopes, which is a partnership with the University of California, which are 10-meter class telescopes. Mm-hmm. A major engineering achievement to have a dish mm-hmm. which is 10 meters across mm-hmm. and to be able to hold it in the face of winds, thermal stresses, to optical precision, and so take pictures of the sky. Mm-hmm. The ability to see further back in time in the universe, or to see closer objects with greater detail, depends on the size of the dish.
Okay.
Basically, it's how much light you can collect.
Mm-hmm.
And if you go from the 10-meter dishes to the 30-meter dish, which I helped get started back in the early 2000s, you will expand your light-gathering capability by 10 times, if you like.
Wow.
And so improve your ability to study the heavens.
Mm-hmm.
We got that started with a little bit of funding from the Moore Foundation, helped a lot, mm-hmm. created a partnership, the Canadians, University of California. Since I've handed the project off in the early 2000s, the partnership has grown.
Mm-hmm.
The expectation is that the dish will be built on a mountain in Hawaii. It's currently stalled, fully designed, all dressed up, ready to go. By discussions with the locals about what can or cannot be put on top of the mountain, which has some great cultural significance for the Hawaiians.
Hmm.
And hopefully that will come to fruition, else they will put the dish elsewhere.
Right. What kind of lessons, then, do you have from some of these big projects for young institutions? I mean, obviously you're in part of a young mm-hmm. section of an institution, but how can young institutions apply some of these learnings?
I think, you know, KAUST, for example, I think has got an extraordinarily good start after mm-hmm. now, what, 8 years, 7 years. Mm-hmm. If you really want to get to the top, I always think about it maybe, you know, unreasonably as front page of the New York Times, right? How do you do things that will get you there? The answer, mm-hmm. I think, is in the research instrumentation. You want to build instruments that let you do science nobody else can do. And the telescopes are an example of that.
Mm-hmm.
The gravity wave example at Caltech is another such example. Seismic networks, in general, they are things that let you get data that nobody else has been able to do before. So I think you want to encourage the faculty mm-hmm. to dream big, and then when you collectively identify that idea, you've got to back it with enough institutional stability and resources so that you can get it done, because it's typically a decade kind of investment. You know, it requires making choices.
Mm-hmm.
If you put investments in one place, you'll not be able to put them in another place.
Mm-hmm.
So it requires a kind of curation of the faculty discussion, stimulation, mm-hmm. by that's what administrators are for, right? Open mind, think big. Don't just buy science by the yard.
Mm-hmm. And once you've bought science by the yard, per se, or you've built the infrastructure, so how do you get your people, how do you get your teams, your people networks to be ready for the leaps that the institution's going to make?
Very tough. It's a cultural thing in mm-hmm. part. It's a leadership thing in part. It depends also on the kind of people that you hire. It's a temperamental thing. You want to hire people who really have a fire in their belly to change the world.
Mm-hmm.
It's not so easy to identify such people, but when you do, you go after them very hard.
Your route to where you are now mm-hmm. was through physics.
Right.
Is that going to continue to be, as you see it, the route for people, particularly going into fields that involve high-performance computing, or do you see a new emerging discipline of its own?
There is certainly, high-performance computing has now gotten to a level of maturity that you need people who are deeply trained in that particular business. However, computing is only a tool,
mm-hmm.
and it's a tool that needs to be applied to something, and you need that domain expertise to really train the best researchers and scientists. We're trying to do that with cities and data in the center. I'll display a little bit of physics chauvinism. The physicists we train, physics is not just a subject, but it's a state of mind and a set of tools. And, you know, when I was much younger, One of my elders told me, you know, a PhD in physics is a license to poke your nose into anybody's business. And I've had great fun doing that. Some of it is involved computing, some of it's involved astronomy, climate science, and so on. So I think the physicists sometimes have a leg up because they get trained fundamentals, first principles, understand the limitations and advantages of models, respect for the data, and the experimentalists get trained to do everything soup to nuts, build the experiment, take the data, and then analyze it. It's not so common in many other fields to be trained like that.
Any things that we should expect from NYU CUSP as the years go on here? Any big 30-meter telescope type projects?
Well, you know, I like to think that the idea of CUSP in the field we've moved into has got that kind of impact, or has that ability to be a big idea, if you like, or a big thing. We haven't been alone at NYU in picking up on that. There are roughly 35 universities and their host cities in the U.S. working on similar things. But, you know, what a home run would be in CUSP is probably a quality of life issue. Some of the sound work that we're doing to try to measure and characterize the sound in the city. Everybody would like to see transportation improved. Those are the sorts of things that we could imagine as home runs within the field itself.
So very tied in a more local way to
yeah,
to
a very practical way. Right. And tied to New York, although I think the ideas and the technologies we are developing can and should be applied to other cities, but we have our own finite resources. There are a lot of cities out there, and we can't do everything, but we can teach people how to do it and catalyze it.
Right, very good. Well, Dr. Koonin, thank you so much for being here and speaking with us today. Okay. We really appreciate it, and we hope you enjoy the rest of your time at KAUST here.
I expect I will. We've been having a great time already.
Excellent, okay. Excellent. And thank you all to our audience for being here. And come back at 12:45. We're going to have another interview right here with Dr. Robert Voigt as well.